Preston, open with the reading, strangely, from the Song of Solomon, chapter 5.
Song of Solomon, chapter 5. Beginning in verse 2. The bride says, I was asleep, but my heart was awake. A voice, my beloved was knocking, open to me, my sister, my darling, my dove, my perfect one. For my head is drenched with dew, my locks with the damp of the night. Her response to him is sad. She says, I've taken off my dress. How can I put it on again? I've washed my feet. How can I dirty them again? My beloved extended his hand through the opening, and my feelings were aroused for him. I arose to open to my beloved, and my hands dripped with myrrh, and my fingers with liquid myrrh on the handles of the bolt. I opened to my beloved, but my beloved had turned away and had gone. My heart went out to him as he spoke. I searched for him, but I did not find him. I called him, but he did not answer me. The watchmen who make the rounds in the city found me. They struck me and wounded me. The guardsmen of the walls took away my shawl from me. I adjure you, O daughters of Jerusalem, if you find my beloved, as to what you will tell him, for I am lovesick. The question comes, what kind of beloved is your beloved, O most beautiful among women? What kind of beloved is your beloved that you thus adjure us? And she says, my beloved is dazzling and ruddy, outstanding among 10,000. His head is like gold, pure gold. His locks are like the clusters of dates and black as a raven. His eyes are like doves beside streams of water, bathed in milk and reposed in their setting. His cheeks are like the bed of balsam, banks of sweet-scented herbs. His lips are lilies, dripping with liquid myrrh. His hands are rods of gold set with beryl. His abdomen is carved ivory inlaid with sapphires. His legs are pillars of alabaster set on pedestals of pure gold. His appearance is like Lebanon, choice as the cedars. His mouth is full of sweetness, and he is wholly desirable. This is my beloved. This is my friend, O daughters of Jerusalem. Well, let's pray. Our everlasting King and our gracious Father, we turn our hearts to you, not because we are a particularly spiritual people, not because we are a particularly strong people, but because we are a needy people. We come to you because you've commanded us. We come to you because you have made a way for us by faith to enter into the Holy of Holies and to lay before your glorious, eternal, boundless throne our childlike praises and our desperate need. God, we are not a self-sufficient people. We cannot afford to have another gimmick through which we waste years of effort. We don't need merely to think of things in the past, though we're grateful for the lessons we learned, but God, it is in the present that we need to meet with you, to hear your voice as we open the scripture day by day. God, we pray that you would deal with us in the coming days in such a way that as individuals or as churches, that there would be a captivation. You would hold our hearts captive with the superior charms of Christ. And when people ask us why we talk about revival or why do we pray for that, why do we read books about things that happened so long ago, that our response would be the same as the wife here, ashamed of our coldness, yes, but God seeking now, we would say, our beloved is chief among 10,000. He is altogether lovely. Lord, we pray that you would so open our eyes to behold who you are that we would never again be at ease with you at a distance. And we ask that you would do this for the honor of your Son, that he would receive all that he has earned in his sufferings. In Christ's name we ask. Amen. Well, yesterday in the afternoon, we began to look at the theme of guiding our desires for God. And so I hope that while Mr. Roberts has been speaking, that the desire has been there. We talked about some different ways that the desire for God might be promoted in a Christian. You can look outside of us and look at the world and you feel the dryness of the world. And like David, you could say it's a spiritual desert out there. And without God, everything is empty. You can also look within your own self and you see the needs there. You see the tasks that God has given you. We have a lot of dads here, or husbands, ministers, spiritual leaders, moms, Christians who work next to lost people. And you know that the things that God has called you to do for his glory are not the kind of things that you can do. It does require that God himself be at work in you and through you. And there are times where we drift from the Lord and people ask us spiritual questions. And to our shame, we give them good answers, cliche answers, true perhaps. But we know between us and the Lord that it's just words. And we ourselves ought to be asking the questions. So you look at the need around you, the task that's in front of you, and it ought to make you long for the nearness of God. One illustration in my mind that I keep when I think about revival. The old writers spent a lot of time talking about revival as being fundamentally the same thing as the work that God does in the salvation of a soul or in evangelism and those things, except so it's the same kind of thing, but lifted to a greater degree. And the importance of understanding that is that you don't have to adapt some silly, outlandish methods to promote revival. It's the same means of grace. It's the prayer. It's the word. It's the gathering together. It's the seeking of the Lord. It's repentance. It's faith and consecration of our hearts afresh. And when God works in revival, we're not looking for crazy, outlandish things. We're looking for the normal things that God does. Real conversions, real sanctification, but we're looking for it at a level that it would be uncommon, extraordinary. So let me give you this illustration. When we think about revival, let's think about the normal work of the church, the wonderful ordinary. I'm not talking about ordinary church, but I'm talking about in a church that's a fairly healthy church, so it'd be uncommon in our day here. But they're experiencing the blessings of the Lord on the ministry, and you might be tempted to call it revival. It's not revival. It's just the wonderful ordinary. People are being changed. People are being bothered by the preaching. People are being helped. Marriages are being rescued. Children are being converted. It's like having a backyard, like one of those English gardens, you know, that we all kind of see on television and admire. But we don't want to do all the work for. And imagine going back there and you're working there and you're planting and you're fertilizing and you're pruning and in your back garden you have a number of very nice plants. That's, in my mind, a picture of the normal work of the church. We're plowing up the ground, we're planting the seed, we're watering it, we're fertilizing it, we're pruning it, we're guarding it. And there is growth here and there, and it's not everything we would like for it to be, but it's encouraging. But revival is like when God plants a field of flowers in a moment, and we walk out of our house and we think, where did that come from? In the little principality of Wales, I lived in the capital city of Cardiff for 3 years, and on the edge of Cardiff, there was a hill called the Wynnwllt, all right? Now, if you were a Welsh person, you say, you didn't say it right, because they will not ever say, I say it right. Or is it W-E-N-A-L-L-T? So it's the Wynnwllt. And on the Wynnwllt, all right, we'll anglicize it for us. You can read in the journals of George Whitefield and Hal Harris and other people that they traveled over this hill headed into the capital city. And so it's still covered in woods. It's on the edge of the city. There's nothing there. And so I would go out early in the morning, sometimes with my Bible, drive down to the edge of the city, and I'd go for a walk through these Welsh hills and the forest there and pray and think about the 18th century sometimes. Now, I'd go about once a week, and so I kept going, and it was just a pretty place. And then springtime came, and I missed a couple of weeks, and then I went one morning, and I walked out, and to my surprise, the entire floor of the forest was covered in these little purple bluebells everywhere. And I hadn't been there for 2 weeks. I didn't see them start to grow. I didn't see them start to blossom. It was, to me, it was overnight. And it was like, that's what revival can be. Now, I know as Americans, we want to manufacture it. We would hire a team of 10,000 people with plants, and they would be out doing it. But, you know, if you get 10,000 people trying to plant all those flowers, you just have a muddy mess at the end. But God, when he works, you read the accounts of revivals, especially in the early days of the 18th century revivals in America and in the UK. You can find preachers in America who are complaining in letters to their fellow ministers because the revival has come to their city. And it's they said, I have had to do more work in a week than I had to do in a year last year before the revival came. I mean, these weren't men that were interested in the revival. God, one writer describes as God, it's like he brings a nation to birth in a moment. So we see the need around us and we realize I can plant all the flowers all the time and I'll never be able to do what's necessary at work or at home or at school. But if God comes, so we seek him. And then there's the superior worth of God. Now, that was yesterday. When that desire is present, then we have to ask those questions, right? If the desire for God is not present, then these questions aren't important to us. The first question is, what we asked yesterday, do I really want that God here and now? Now, don't ask yourself this, have there been times in my life that I've wanted that God here and now? Because I can look in my life and say, there have been times where I have wanted that God right here and now. And I don't care what the cost is. He's my Father. He's my Redeemer. I want his nearness. And then there have been long stretches in my life as a pastor where I would say, I want to be back there, but I'm not there. And I don't want him here right now. I know that we can't make God come close by wanting him enough, and that's not at all what I mean. But like the wife in the Song of Solomon, when she has offended the husband and he leaves and her heart is stirred and she goes looking for him, the American church, we ought to be like that. God has withdrawn his manifest presence. It's been a long time. So long so that for most of us, it really reads like a fairy tale, some of the early histories of revival in our nation. But I think of like a wife who has a husband in the Navy and he's been off, you know, with tour of duty, and his tour is over, and he's coming home, and she is not sure exactly when he's coming home. He's supposed to be home at such and such time, and let's say she goes down to the naval base every day, you know, the week leading up to it, and maybe the officer say, ma'am, you can't make your husband come back any faster by showing up here every day. I know, she would say, I know, I can't help it. We're not going to make God bring revival. And if every one of us had hearts earnestly set on God coming, it would not earn his visitation. But it ought to be fundamental to us that because of the need, because of the dryness, because of his beauty and what he's done in our hearts, we're like the woman that admits the logic of it. Yes, I know, I can't make him come, but I can't help it. And we look and we long and we plead. If that's the condition of our heart in some measure, then we have to ask a second question. How can God draw near to a people like us and it be a life-giving experience? And again, this is what we talked about yesterday, trying to clarify in case I just ran circles yesterday and you didn't know what in the world I was talking about. Who God is determines how we seek him. So, who you believe God to be is already determining right now, yesterday, the day before, your views of God are already determining how you are seeking him presently. If we have a big view of God, a biblical view of God, when I say big, it's not big enough. God's infinite. So if we have a biblically enlarged and informed view of God, and He is ever growing in our understanding, and so we are ever shrinking, then the gap between the two of us is going to get big. I remember one time Mr. Roberts spoke at the church in Mississippi where I pastor, and he warned us that if you pursue a high and holy view of God, you're going to have a low view of yourself, and there's going to be a giant gap, and you're going to need a cross that is big. Do you know that in the 17th century, if you read the pastoral books that deal with counseling, the number one counseling issue that I've been able to find for the English Puritans, and they wrote a lot of books, is the issue of church members, of Christians, bothered by the gap between them and God and afraid that maybe He doesn't love a person like me. Why would He? So the struggle for assurance. And I remember reading a historian who pointed that out and thinking to myself, it's a no-brainer. Jesus died for the lost. I've accepted Jesus. But as I grew as a Christian, I realized as my understanding of God increases, I need an ever-increasing grasp of the work of Christ, or I will despair. Small God, big you, very little need for the gospel. Really, all you need is what? Ask Jesus into your hearts, and you'll be saved. Once saved, always saved. And that's enough for you. You don't ask for anything more. But if your view of God is increasingly accurate and your view of self is increasingly honest, then you really are driven back to the Bible again and again with this question: God, tell me again what He has done. His person, His work, the one that's all my hope. Show me again the glories of Christ, and show me the beauties of the redemptive work of Christ from eternity past to eternity future. I really need to hear it again, because sometimes I'm just afraid that you wouldn't want to have anything to do with a person like me. What we believe about God affects how we approach the gospel. Now, when I say what we believe about God, I don't mean what your official beliefs are. A.W. Tozer said this: only after a painful ordeal of self-probing are we likely to discover what we actually think about God. So if I ask you, would you write down what you think about God? You might be able to quickly jot it off, but it's a very different thing from being in the middle of life circumstances, and at that moment something hits you and your real views of God are expressed in what you do next. It's not easy to know what we really think of God, because being in church so much, we kind of learn to blind ourselves. But let me give you a test. Everyone needs to have one of these booklets, all right? So have you got one? If you don't, are they on the back, in the back still? Here's one. There's one on the front row here. And everyone will need something to write with, all right? It's your midterm exam. Anyone need one that doesn't have one? You're gonna write in that book, all right? I want you to turn to, it's probably the second page, is it? No, what page? Okay, all right, second page. This is a little test for us, and I'm going to give you 10 minutes, all right? Do your best. It's a list of biblical words. Now, they are theological words, but I don't think I included any word in there that is a theological word that's not also a biblical word. All right, so don't think, well, of course I don't know that word. That's out of some egghead's brain, and you can't expect us to know that one. All right, so words like superlapsarianism, which really is a word, I don't care if you know what in the world that's talking about, and I wouldn't be able to write that one in anymore anyway. But these are words in the scripture that the Holy Spirit has given us. They all deal with the topic of your soul's rescue. So I'm going to give you a moment. Could you just write down in 10 minutes your definition of those biblical words? All right, so do your best. All right, that's enough. A very simplified answer key is followed on the next page or so, and I don't want you to check yourself right now, all right? Here's what I want to ask. not how did you do, but here's the question I want to ask. What were we just testing you on? Well, you were being tested on a certain level of biblical knowledge. I mean, how well do you know the words that are in your own Bible? Words like justification or sanctification or, you know, regeneration and glorification. I mean, what do these words talk about? So we were testing your knowledge of a biblical doctrine, the doctrine of salvation. But you are also really testing your attitude toward the work of Christ in saving your souls. Because we would have to admit that if we've been a Christian for some time, and we've owned a Bible, and we've been in church, if our attitude toward the gospel is one of a real earnest concern that we get it right, we probably would have known those words. And if our attitude was that whatever my preacher says, that I kind of go along with that, and I've always been religious, then we'd be pretty careless with those words. But I think that the most significant thing is that we were also testing your truest view of God in an indirect way. Again, your concern, your level of concern to know and live upon the doctrines of redemption are in direct correlation to your view of God. Small God, small knowledge of the gospel is enough. Large God, I need all those words very clearly spelled out. I want to know when God is big and I am small in my eyes, I am not concerned only to know the word saved, which is an umbrella term that would include all of that. I want to know the small print of the new covenant. So for many, you may have to say, I really need to stop here and quit talking about revival, because you do understand that if you have fashioned a God in your own mind that is not the God of the Bible, one that is so small and so manageable and so reasonable and so much like you that you don't feel that there's much of a gap, and so the words that the Holy Spirit has chosen to give you to spell out the small print of your covenant hope, if your view of God is so inappropriate, then maybe you don't know God at all, and the one that we've been talking about all week, when you talk about God, you're talking about an idol. It will not please the living God for a group of people to get together, and some of the people in that group to have such a wrong view of God that really it's an idol in the heart, and they wholeheartedly focus on drawing near to an idol. If I go home, and when I get home, there's someone sitting at my place at the table wearing my clothes, eating my favorite food, drinking from my favorite coffee cup, who looks a lot like me, and my family said to me, Dad, we knew you'd be thrilled that we replaced you with a guy that was almost like you, and we have treated him so well. I would not be flattered. When Mr. Roberts talks about making the road straight, that God might draw near to us, when Mr. Roberts talks about in James 7, what these seven things we can do so that we might set our hearts to return to Him, if it's an idol that is behind all that you're doing, you understand that it's an aggravated sin that he talked about. It's worse than indifference. So we have to ask ourselves, ask ourselves individually, does my handling of the gospel truths reveal that I have a very wrong view of God? Is it so wrong that it really isn't God that I think of when I think of God? And do I have to begin in talking about revival, not by talking about how to seek the Lord in prayer, but in repenting of allowing an idol to be placed in my heart? What if you say, I don't think that all this theology stuff is so important. I just need God. Let me give you an example of what happens. Mr. Roberts mentioned to you the country of Wales had so many revivals from the 1735 onward. There were even some in the century prior to that. One of the Welsh Puritans wrote a letter to his fellow ministers in England, and they said, how does the work go in Wales? And he used this phrase that's become famous. He said, the gospel spreads like fire in the thatch. It's like fire in dry grass. It's just going wild. But it's been a long time since Wales has had that kind of a work. When I was in Wales, I usually preached in evangelical churches, but sometimes I preached in churches that weren't evangelical churches. They were kind of the old standard denominational churches that had long ago forgotten those words that you just got tested on and no longer thought they were that important. I mean, these are churches that don't believe that Christ really raised from the dead. They feel that he swooned on the cross and in the cold grave revived, but he was never dead. And if you've heard Paul Washer preach on propitiation, and you were part of that denomination, you would think that he was a barbarous maniac who screamed about a God and yelled and cried about God crushing his own son for somebody else's sin. So these are truly liberal churches. Well, one time I preached at a church like this, and you can always tell them, they only have 10 or 11 elderly people left. And a couple of grandchildren who were forced to go along with grandma, you know, and a few husbands. So this group of 10 or 11 elderly ladies, after I preached a sermon, came up to me and they said, oh, we're waiting for it to happen again. Now, I didn't know what they were talking about. I thought, well, what happened last week? I don't know what you're talking about, you know. So I said, yes. And they said, and then the next lady, oh, we're waiting for it to happen again. And so I just kept saying yes to everybody because I thought I'm headed out that door and I don't know what they're talking about. And another lady said, and finally I said to him, ma'am, what? And she said, for the 04, which is the 04 revival. We're waiting for revival to happen again. Now listen, these women did not believe Christ raised from the dead, many of them. These women did not believe that Christ was crushed under the Father's wrath for their sins. They thought that their children were good children and then their baptized grandchildren were fine Christian kids. They don't believe the fundamental things they have to believe if God is going to draw near to them in a life-giving way, but they have this vague idea that revival is going to fix their church and fill it up again. And that's where you and I will be if our view of God is so inadequate that we handle the gospel carelessly but talk a lot about revival. So that's certainly not what we're interested in. Now, the good news for those of us that would say, I didn't do so well on the test, and I think that I need to start thinking about this. Because when I say that your view of God is connected to how you treat the gospel, I'm not saying this. If you have a high view of God, a biblical view of God, you'll be a good Bible student, and you'll crack down and you'll learn those words. Well, that might be true, but that's really not what I'm interested in. If the view of God is biblical and the view of yourself is biblical, you will be driven, not because you're a good student, but because you are the needy sinner, driven again and again. Before I preach, we have a prayer meeting, and I sit in my pulpit. I plop down in my pulpit during the prayer meeting, and I oftentimes have to go right back to God and say to him, show me the small print again. How can I speak on your behalf? God, look at my mind, my heart. I am capable of such horrible things. God, I don't know how I can even call myself a Christian. After I preach, I go to my study sometimes. God, show me it again. Are you sure that you would love a person like me? Listen, it's not because I'm a great Bible student. It's because I'm a beggar who's been adopted into the family. I have one hope, a generous father, and I have to go back again and again and again. But if you have a big view of yourself, you treat all the nitty-gritty of the new covenant like I treat those agreements that you have to check off on your computer when you get an updated app or an updated software and it says, read all of this and to buy your cell phone. You have to use my Apple cell phone. I have to read pages and pages. I'm never going to read that. They could say, John, we can do anything with your bank account we want, and I would never know that. I've never read their agreements. I just go all the way to the bottom, and I hit the thing that says, yeah, I agree. But that's how people in our churches are treating the new covenant. Oh, no, that's fine. Jesus, I trust you. Everything's cool. You know, it's all kosher. We're okay, and I just want revival. And you don't even know the gospel. Well, the good news is this, that if we don't want to, if we're there and we don't want to stay there, or if we want to move forward, the New Testament was written to a group of people just like that. Paul comes to a town and they don't know anything about God except this wretched idol that they've grown up with in their city. Then Paul tells them about the living God and the Messiah and the cross and the hope that there is. And they embrace that. But now they're at square one, aren't they? And they've got to rethink everything. God is nothing like the God that they grew up hearing about. And for many of us, sadly, it's almost that great of a gap between what we grew up with and what the Bible says. So when Paul and Peter and John and James, when they write these letters to these baby churches and these young Christians, it's custom designed for people like us who need to rethink God. And in the process of doing that, we have to rethink what the gospel is. Another bit of good news is this, that many of the revivals have been led by young people who had to rethink who God is because they grew up in homes that weren't Christian or in denominations that were very flawed. And in rethinking God, they had to rethink the gospel. And that is particularly the case in the United Kingdom in the 18th century, what they call the evangelical revival, but it was linked with what we call the First Great Awakening here. When those men were converted, George Whitefield, famous name, John Wesley, but there are so many others. When they were brought to the Lord, George Whitefield at age 21, and two other Welshmen. It's interesting how the Lord worked, but Whitefield was in England, and these two Welshmen, and the Welshmen didn't know each other until 4 years afterward. But in 1735, George Whitefield was converted, so was a man named Hal Harris, and so was a man named Daniel Rowland, and they were converted within days of each other. 4 years later, Whitefield meets Hal Harris. They're both preachers. And Whitefield's first question to him is, do you know that your sins are forgiven? Because as a good Anglican, that wasn't a normal question. God raised up these young men, but when they were saved, they didn't get saved like this. They didn't go to a great Bible college and belong to very careful churches. And through the careful raising up of their parents, because they were all homeschooled, of course, and then they got all this great doctrine. And then at the end of the process, they said, you know, I want to give my life to that king. And they have all that foundation there to build on. No, they grew up in the Church of England. And they were baptized as children, and they occasionally took their communion. And many of them were ministers. They trained at Oxford. And when they met the Lord and they had the experience of the new birth and of conversion, they didn't know. Whitefield wrote, I don't know any other man alive who has had what I've had. I've not met one. So when he goes to church, he looks around, he talks, nobody there. His minister, his priest, no, I don't know what you're talking about. So before he meets other believers, like-minded, he goes to old books. And he has Matthew Henry's commentary and his Bible and his New Testament. And for months, he pours back and forth. And then he gets other old writers as well. Now, what I'm saying is this. The Bible is our guide, but we would be foolish not to benefit from the men a few centuries earlier who, when they were in their 20s, had to rethink everything. Because they did rethink everything, and they really did a good job. And the product was the ongoing fruit of that word-centered revival, and not just one revival, but many revivals in that century. So we're going to borrow a little help from those guys as we go. Now, here's another lesson I want us to learn, all right? And you're going to need your book again. When these men in the 18th century, these young 20-ish-year-old guys began to preach, and God began to bring thousands to faith through their preaching, and you can read the accounts that some really, we're going to talk about Scotland in a minute, and here's a book called The Cambuslang Revival. These are not for giveaway. These are Anthony's, you know. I'll give them away, but he'll probably ask for them back. This is a great one on a revival that occurred in outside of Glasgow, Scotland in the 18th century, one of the really bright spots there. And this is a book called Revivals of the 18th Century that also deals a lot with the UK. There is another book that Anthony said he already gave away to somebody, so I can't show it to you, by J.C. Ryle, R-Y-L-E, called Great Leaders of the 18th Century, or something close to that, where he takes about 10 of the leaders of the revival in the UK and gives about 40 pages of a biography on each one. It was an international movement. The continent, the UK, particularly Scotland, Wales, and England, some later in Ireland, and then, of course, in America, really starting in America with Jonathan Edwards preaching the doctrine of what? Anybody know? I give you all the money in my pocket, my front pocket. Right? I got a credit card in my back pocket. All the money in my front pocket. Jonathan Edwards preached a series on justification. Do you think that's what would spark revival? A series on how we're forgiven through the finished work of Christ? Jonathan Edwards preached on justification, and the Lord used it to begin an extraordinary work there in Northampton, a place that had seen five waves of revival under his grandfather's ministry, Solomon Stoddard. He put together a short account of that and sent it to the UK, where Isaac Watts and another man went together and published it, and Watts was well known, so he puts his name on there and says, basically, look, guys, I want us to read this. And churches throughout, the believers throughout the United Kingdom begin to read it, and it stirs up such a longing that they begin to pray that God would not forget them, that he would also visit them, and then we have in 1735 these many conversions, and the young men begin to be extraordinarily blessed. I mean, George Whitfield, you can read the accounts. He preaches to the coal miners early in the morning before they go to the mines, or after they get out of the mines. After they get out, he says their faces are just soot covered. And as he preaches, he's preaching out in the fields because no church can hold them. There's thousands of them, and their faces are all guttered with tears. Just extraordinary. God raised them up and did an extraordinary work. But what was the theme that they felt that needed to be preached in order to promote revival? Well, look in your book again, and if you flip through a couple pages, you've got that test, and you've got the theological glossary, and then you've got a blank page, and then one that says the works of George Whitfield. And this is just some of his sermons. We don't have hardly any of his sermons. His memoirs and remains were lost, and they've never been recovered. I want to point out just a few of the titles of these sermons, and I want you to notice how often Whitfield's theme is not revival, but rather the gospel and Christ. And under the unveiling of Christ's glory and the gospel in the preaching of George Whitfield, God brings such a mighty work. Now, before we look at this, I have to say, I have spoken on revival many times. Mr. Roberts is speaking on revival. I am not saying that we shouldn't ever speak on revival. But what I'm saying is this. The 18th century is a wonderful demonstration that the how of us coming to God is a significant foundation and heart of all real longing for God's nearness. If we don't have this, then we end up with those Welsh ladies just wanting some experience, and we don't even know the God that would bring it. So, sermon one, the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. Not the number one sermon on our sermon audio, probably. But there he's describing Christ as the covenant redeemer. Next page, sermon 12, toward the bottom, Christ the believer's husband. Back on the other page, sorry, sermon 5, Christ the best husband. So he's talking about the work of Christ in the believer. Page 9, sermon 14, the Lord our righteousness. Sermon 15, the righteousness of Christ and everlasting righteousness. Sermon 17, the temptation of Christ. Sermon 19, Christ who supports the tempted. Sermon 21, Christ the only rest for the weary and heavy laden. Sermon 23 on the next page, the marks of a true conversion. 24, what think ye of Christ? Then we have another volume of his works. Keep turning. Another contents page. It says number 7 at the bottom, page 7. It's sermon 33, the gospel supper. Sermon 35, the conversion of Zacchaeus. 38 on the next page, the indwelling of the Spirit. 40, that's an XL there. The Holy Spirit convincing the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. 41, Saul's conversion. 43, the almost Christian. 44, Christ, the believer's wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. 45, the knowledge of Christ, the best knowledge. 46, justification by Christ. 49, on regeneration. And this is just a sampling. If you read the journals and the letters and the sermons of the early, these young men who are revivalists, and you read their enemies' writings about them, you will find that the constant theme of the 18th century was Christ and His glorious work. And that was, in that century, what God used. Now, in part, I think the reason for God using that theme in such an extraordinary way, and not the theme of revival, for instance, is that these were people who, while they were church members, as Anglicans, really knew almost nothing about the gospel. They had their church form and the beauty and the dignity and the priest and the baptism and the Eucharist, and that was about the extent of it. And so you may think, well, in our day, we need to preach on revival, but I think we're right back where they were, where people go to church and they say, I have my baptism, I was age 7, not age 7 days, and the preacher told me I was a Christian, and I've grown up in the youth group, and I've served on the traveling, you know, clown team or puppet team, and I've done it all. And if you say to them, so explain to me the connection between regeneration and sanctification, and they would look at you and think, I didn't know I was supposed to know that. So I think that once again, we do have to be careful that we don't skip the gospel in order to focus on that. Now, we're going to look at some of those themes that Whitfield preached on a little bit today and then tomorrow and the next day, all right? So today we're going to look at the doctrine of regeneration or the new birth. The central theme of the 18th century revival preaching, more than any other, the great theme was the doctrine of the new birth. The thing that infuriated George Whitfield's church, the Church of England, and stirred up the most articles, books, and sermons against him was not his preaching on repentance, which he preached a lot, or faith, or justification by faith alone, or holiness, and he preached on all that, but it was the doctrine of regeneration. Now, one reason was, if you were an Anglican, you believed that because of what the priest said when you gave him your child, that the Holy Spirit was joined with those waters and that child was regenerated. He was born again, like a Roman Catholic baptism, christening. That child is already born again. And now, as that child grows, he needs to be taught and he needs to repent and believe and be a good Anglican. But he doesn't need to be born again. Again, he already got that. And Whitfield and Wesley and the other men said, we highly doubt the profession of any person that says, I was born again in my baptism, who has lived their entire life for themselves. It just didn't happen. So they preached in a sense of what we would agree with, you must be born again. And the baptism didn't do it. So that really infuriated their bishops and their theologians, and they wrote all these books against George Whitfield. In George Whitfield's journals, from the year 1734 to the year 1744, those 11 years, then he quit publishing them because there were a lot of problems with the way people would treat them. He kept the first 11 years, those 11 years in a journal, and he mentions the doctrine of the new birth 46 times. He mentions the doctrine of justification by faith only 8 times. Not because he doesn't believe in it, but because he feels the thing that people need to understand so very clearly is that you must be born again. Now, this might seem strange to us because we think, well, being born again, that's the simplest thing in the world, but it's not really, is it? And even though we still have the phrase, we don't necessarily still have the reality in our churches. My final semester at seminary for my master's degree, I didn't have enough hours to graduate. And so they said to me, you're going to have to come back next year. And I thought, no, I am not coming back next year. We're finishing this now. So I took an extra course, and it had to be an independent study. So I had to just do a lot of reading and write a paper, and then the professor would grade it. But I didn't go to a class. And I was thinking of a couple of themes. One was the doctrine of repentance, and one was the doctrine of regeneration, or the new birth. And I was thinking of the doctrine of regeneration because I'd just heard Mr. Roberts. I'd met Mr. Roberts 22 years ago, and I'd heard him say the most significant doctrine for the American church 22 years ago, the one that's most misunderstood is the doctrine of regeneration. And I thought to myself, well, I know what the doctrine of regeneration is. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and then you get born again, and then you... So I decided, well, he said that, and I really would rather do a paper on repentance, but I'll try this doctrine of regeneration. And so I went and looked for books on regeneration. I couldn't find many, and then I found all these old books. And to my surprise, as I looked at the old books and then looked back at my Bible, I had a completely wrong view. I thought that the new birth was something that I did to myself. I thought the new birth was a result of something I did. Okay, God, I'm willing. Now you make me all new on the inside, okay? I stir myself up. I do what you say. And then you reward me with the new birth. Like, as if it were the same thing as adoption. We're facing a day again where the doctrine of the new birth, while not denied in word, is really denied in practice. I have been on staff at a few churches, not that many. I have been asked to give my testimony each time, but I have never had anyone stop me and say, now I want you to go back, you said you asked Jesus into your heart such and such, now tell me about the work of God in your soul at that time. No one ever asks. But if I was going to be a youth minister, they did stop and say, wait, so tell me your plans for how you're going to grow our youth group. In practice, we are not looking for men transformed by regeneration to fill our pulpits. We're looking for men who are capable and talented. And in practice, we are not looking for the evidences of regeneration when we baptize our children and make them members of churches. Most churches, if you talked about a credible evidence of regeneration, wouldn't know what you were talking about. But that was, in America, once a standard. We're looking for a believable, outward evidence that you're alive in Christ, and not that you've just asked Jesus into your heart. So at the end of seminary, I realized I don't think about regeneration the way the Bible talks about it. Regeneration has been, as I mentioned, in the 18th century, it was a central doctrine. Let me give you the story of what happened in Scotland, then we're going to take a break. Then we'll come back and we'll look at what the Bible says about regeneration. In the early 1740s, in the city of Cambuslang and in the neighboring town of Kilsyth. Now, these are small towns on the outside of a big city in Scotland called Glasgow. These two cities had ministers that were very faithful in them in the Presbyterian Church. One was named James Robe and another William McCulloch. I believe it's William. And they kept a very detailed account of their pastoring during these years. So we know what happened. Robe, preaching in Kilsyth, wrote a book called A Faithful Narrative of the Extraordinary Work of the Spirit of God at Kilsyth and Other Congregations in 1742. But long before he was able to write a book talking about the extraordinary work of God in his church, he kept a journal of how miserable it was at his church, leading up to that, the spiritual dark period. Robe came to Kilsyth in 1713. So if the book is published in 1742, that's 29 years later, right? So 29 years later, he's able to publish a book. But for the most part, his ministry has been working among people that are unresponsive. He writes about the conditions in the church. He says the church and the town, he says, there's superstition, there's drunkenness, violence, cursing, and immorality that results in a number of illegitimate children in the church. These were all found among church members, he says. There were bitter divisions in the church leadership when he came there, and there were societies for prayer that had been established years before, but by this time they dwindled down and died. That is the situation that he pastored in for 20 years. Anybody having a hard time imagining it? Pregnant girls in the church who aren't married, superstition, drunkenness, violence, cursing. division in church leadership. Prayer meeting's dead. Nobody attends it. 20 years. He writes this, formal strictness concerning holiness and tenderness of life had been much relaxed. A formal round of profession duties was the religion of the professors. That's his old way of saying people still went to church and did kind of religious things. But the multitude were visibly profane. Things had become so bad with us that there were few that we, the ministers, could comfort as believers when they were dying. So as a pastor of the church, as a parish minister, as a, in the Church of Scotland, he would have been the minister of an entire like region, a parish. So when the people lie dying, he said, things had gotten so spiritually bad in our town, our city, that there were really very few that when they died, I could say to them, your soul has hope in Christ. Robe was very godly. Robe was very faithful, studious, industrious, very methodical, not a very talented preacher, not considered above average. He was average. And then there was this other fellow named McCulloch in the neighboring town, and they were friends and both concerned about the spiritual condition. And McCulloch was even a more average, less than average preacher. He was nicknamed the Ale Minister, A-L-E, you know, British beer, the beer preacher. Why do you call a preacher the beer preacher? If you call Anthony the beer pastor, well, we would think that's because he drinks a lot of beer. But it's not what the issue was with McCulloch. When he got ready to preach, the men would quietly filter out the back of the church and go to the pub and have a pint. And when the time for church was finished, they'd come back in. They called him the ale minister because the sale of liquor was so good when he was preaching because people thought he was a pretty boring man. Now, he wasn't an ungodly preacher. He was doing his best, but he was not a very capable speaker. Both of these men tried to renew the emphasis in prayer, and they began to pray together. They cried out to the Lord. And while they prayed, they made a very interesting decision. We need to preach on themes that will promote in our people a longing for God. And so the theme they chose was the doctrine of the new birth. And both of them began to preach on that. They preached about a year each on that. McCulloch and Robe both record the extraordinary results in the midst of preaching a very normal doctrine like the new birth that God began to awaken people and break their hearts and save them, and the church began to be transformed. Then they invited a guy named George Whitfield to come from England. And when he came in 1740, early 1740s, he preached on the new birth. And what he said merely, I mean, you imagine if your preacher's been preaching for a year and your dead church is really being, it's being shaken by this doctrine, and people you know that you think are just fine people are being saved, and you're not sure what to think about all this. And then this great preacher, George Whitfield, comes, who nobody calls the beer preacher, and everyone shows up to hear him, and he says the same thing that your pastor has been saying back home. Well, it just confirmed what they were saying, and it was the beginning of the Campus Lang revival. It is considered by many to be the greatest revival in that century in all of Scotland. It went on and on and on and affected countless people. This is how Robe, the preacher who was keeping track of all this, this is how he described it. He said, an extraordinary power of the Spirit accompanied the word preached. That's not just George Whitfield. That's all the preachers in the area that were preaching in that time. There was a great mourning in the congregation. Many cried out. And these were not only women. That was the accusation. Well, your women are emotional. But some of the strong and stout-hearted men. He went on to say that there were so many under conviction that he had to set up these inquiry meetings that Mr. Roberts talked about, that this after meeting. So he would say, if you're bothered about your soul, please stay afterward. And the church that used to empty itself when he preached, now it was so full, he said, we couldn't fit everyone in there. And when we got everyone into the building and I tried to talk to them about what to do with their burdened souls, he said, the weeping was so loud that no one could hear me. Later, he wrote this. Oh, that God would stay a long time with us after this sort. Oh, it is a precious visit. He has wounded, and He will heal us. Oh, let heaven and earth praise Him. 20 years He labors. 20 years He prays. At the end of that time, others start to join Him in prayer. He preaches on regeneration, and God draws near. And God did stay for a long time. And that's really what we're looking for too, isn't it? Well, let's take a quick break. Let's get back to the doctrine of regeneration. The second sermon George Whitefield preached was the doctrine was on regeneration, and it became the best-selling sermon that he ever preached. Benjamin Franklin in the United States published a lot of Whitefield sermons and was friendly with George Whitefield. Never, as far as Whitefield knew, never embraced Christ. But George Whitefield was madly popular in his early 20s. He would have been one of the most famous Christians in the Western world. So if you publish his sermons, you make a lot of money. So Benjamin Franklin was a smart guy and he made a lot of money. Doctrine of regeneration. All right, am I on? Hello, you got me? Hello? How long were you going to let me do that one? Yeah, I was hearing something. Okay. Normally, it's my glasses I can't find, you know? I have asked my wife where my glasses are while I wear them. Like, do you see my glasses? So. Well, let's talk about what does the Scripture teach us about the doctrine of regeneration or the new birth? It is the kind of a doctrine that it's easy to take for granted, as I did, but it is also a doctrine that is at the heart of what God does in us in making us Christians, not what God does for us outside of us, all right? So the death of Christ on the cross, resurrection of Christ, those are things He's done for us. They are objective. They are outside of us. But regeneration is the beginning of what He's doing in us. So God makes us alive. He wakes us up. He puts life into what was dead. He takes the stony heart out, puts the soft heart in. We'll talk about some of those metaphors in a minute. When we talk about regeneration, I suppose we can start with the need for regeneration. Why do we need to be born all over again? And do we really believe that? Well, obviously, it's the effects of sin, not just of the kind of sins that we do, but the sin that's in our nature through Adam and Eve. We've inherited the guilt of our foreparents, and we've inherited the pollution of their nature. We were all born bent decisively toward us. The Bible says we don't think right, we don't desire right, and we don't choose rightly. Romans 3, verse 10 and 11, Paul writes this. He's quoting from the Old Testament. There is none righteous, no, not one. There is none who understands, all right, the mind. Something's happened to the way we think. We don't understand. There's none who seeks after God. Something's happened to the desires of humans. They've all turned aside. They have all become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one. Something's happened to the will or the volition or the choices. When sin entered into humanity through Adam's choice, every one of Adam's children were born spiritually dead. That is, spiritually unresponsive, like a corpse, to God. We don't think right about God. We don't want what's right. And we don't choose what's right. So the Bible describes the effects of this terrible disease in a number of ways. We are blind. Ephesians 4:18, Paul says that the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened. and being alienated from the life of God. Now, when Paul writes that to the Ephesians, he's saying, look, you remember what you were. You were blind. Your mind was darkened. You were alienated from the life of God. So there's a certain blindness. There is an enslavement to sin. John chapter 8, Christ says, most assuredly, I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave of sin. And Romans 6 backs that up in verse 16 and 17. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one's slave whom you obey? And then later he says, you were slaves of sin. So you see the picture. We're spiritually dead. That is, we're blind. We're enslaved. We're held captive. Luke chapter 11, that well-known parable. When a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace, his goods are in peace. But when a stronger than he comes upon him and overcomes him, he takes from him all his armor in which he is trusted, and he divides his spoils. So, wonderful picture of what Christ has to do. We are the spoils. We are held in the house, the fortress of the strong man, of Satan. Sin has us locked in, and it's only the stronger, Christ, that can come and free us. The need for regeneration is also seen in the fact that we are subjects of this tyrant. Colossians 1, verse 13, it says, God has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love. And the wording there in the Greek is very important. Power of darkness has the idea of a tyrannical rule. You were once in the kingdom of darkness, under the tyrannical influence of its king, but you have now been brought out of that kingdom and placed in the kingdom of His Son. You do understand that being spiritually dead, that being spiritually blind and enslaved and held captive and subjects in the wrong kingdom, it means that no one has ever migrated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. No one has ever gotten up and on their own said to themselves, this is a rotten kingdom to live in. And over there is the kingdom of light. And there the subjects are ruled by a perfect king, a clean king, a loving king. I'm going to go over there. Paul says, he didn't say, I'm so grateful that you people woke up and you decided to get into the new kingdom. He says, you were conveyed. Christ comes. The strong man's conquered. You're brought out. Another description of the depth of our need is that we cannot even understand spiritual realities and help ourselves. 1 Corinthians 2:14, the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. So the condition of the lost person is so bad that even if you sit down with them and you explain to them the way of life, apart from the work of the Spirit, apart from regeneration, they will look at you and say, I just don't see what the big deal is. I'm sorry. Next, the Bible says that the need for regeneration is reflected also in the fact that you can't change yourself. Not only do you not understand, but if you could understand, you couldn't fix yourself. Now, I know we can change the outside, but listen to what Jeremiah says in 13:23. Can the Ethiopian change his skin or the leopard its spots? Then you may also do good who are accustomed to do evil. Inside you, there is this rut in your soul. You always go into that rut. Every time you do anything, you slide into that rut. What you are is the problem, not just what you're doing. Our conscience has become so defiled, Paul says to Titus, that we don't even recognize how bad it is. He says in Titus 1:15, to those who are defiled and unbelieving. He says, nothing is pure. Then he goes on to say, they profess to know God, but in their works they deny Him. How does that look in church? In your packet, you have a series of notes. You don't have to look at them now, but I think Anthony was the one that helped me. He always helps me with old sermon notes. He's very meticulous. He doesn't throw anything away. Everything's on his computer. But everything I wrote down on a piece of paper is somewhere in the bottom of my car. I don't know where it is, so Anthony helps me. But Mr. Roberts preached a number of times on regeneration in the church where I pastor, and Anthony kept notes, and other times you'd heard him. So you have a skeleton outline of things that Mr. Roberts has said. But let me give you the one that deals with spiritual death, marks of spiritual death, because I want you to think of this. How do you recognize a person that's still spiritually dead, but they go to church all the time? 12 marks of being spiritually dead. When you are unaffected by God's sovereign rights in your life or His rights in the world. When you are careless or indifferent about the state of your own soul. When you are freely without any power, when you sin freely, and you are without any powerful conviction of sin. You have no dread of hell or the right of God to send you there. You are unchanged by what you know. And you confess to believe about Jesus Christ. You're Pharisee-like with an interest in the form of religion rather than the truth and the heartfelt religion. You are indifferent to the means of grace. You want enough religion to be free from the penalty of sin, but not from its power. You're recognized by the world as one of its own. You fail to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. You are uncaring concerning the glory of God and the spread of His kingdom throughout the world, and you are earthly-minded instead of heavenly-minded. And Christian can act that way at times. Some of these we could read through the list and we could check them, but the spiritually dead in church are habitually this way. Why do we need to be regenerated? Because that's our condition apart from the new birth. What is the nature of regeneration? What does the Bible say? Well, it uses a number of metaphors, and these are so helpful. They're just so simple. They do us a lot more good than a massive book on regeneration. So let me just give you four. The Bible describes regeneration with the metaphor of new birth or being born again. You know, Christ's conversation with Nicodemus, John 3:3, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Whatever the new birth is, whatever regeneration is, it is so drastic that the metaphor of being birthed all over again, it's not a new start in life, it's a new life to start with. It's just totally new. 1 Peter talks about it in chapter 1, verse 23. He says to the people, having been born again, not of corruptible but seed, but of incorruptible through the word of God which lives and abides forever. So there's a new birth. Second, there is a washing and renewing. Titus 3:5, according to His mercy, He saved us through the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. So something happens in regeneration that doesn't just clean up the outside, but goes all the way to the soul, to the heart of the matter, and there is a washing within. Something is renewed within. Number three, it is a new creation. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. It is God going to that place where there is the ruin of sin and recreating, newly creating a spiritual heart, a soul that is able to respond to Him. Fourth, it is to be made alive or to be raised from the dead. Ephesians 2, verse 5 and 6. Even when we were dead in trespasses, He made us alive together with Christ. By grace you've been saved. And He raised us up together. Colossians 2, verse 13. You, being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, He has made alive together with Him, having forgiven you all trespasses. All right, so those are the metaphors. Let's take those four. When a person comes, when God saves the soul and they come to Him, what has happened? In a wonderful way, in a way that is hard for us to understand. Jesus says to Nicodemus, you see the wind's effects, but you don't see the wind. So in the work of regeneration, we see the effects of the Holy Spirit at work in a life. It's not as if we see any glowing light, or we look back and it's even hard for us to understand when it all began, perhaps. But it is so drastic. It is being born all over again. It is being washed within, newly created or recreated and raised from the dead. Do you think that those metaphors are overstatements, hyperbole, meant to get our attention, or understatements? They're understatements. To create something, to wash something, to bring something to birth, to raise something from the dead, even to raise something from the dead, like Lazarus. It is all of those, individually and cumulatively, pale in comparison with the work of the Spirit in making a person alive in Christ, of giving them the new birth. Now, who's the agent of the new birth? Well, this is where we really get in trouble as Americans in our modern world, because we just don't like to be dependent on someone else. All four of those would require that God Himself is the actor. You can't birth yourself. You didn't birth yourself physically, did you? You didn't beget yourself. You didn't decide when it was time for your parents to have you. You cannot wash the interior of your soul. You cannot create yourself anew. You cannot raise yourself from the dead. God acts upon a passive person when He regenerates. Now, we're going to talk about conversion tomorrow. That is faith and repentance. And we are not passive in faith and repentance. We believe. We repent. But before anyone has ever believed or repented, the cause of that is that God has acted upon them in a way that wakes them up. You remember what Paul said? We don't understand, we don't seek, we don't do what's right. But when regeneration occurs, now we're alive to God, and the eyes see what they never saw before. I mean, every believer here, surely you know what that's like, right? 1,000 times you hear the preacher preach the same old stuff. Then you come and you hear, and it's like your ears and eyes are opened, and you think he's never said that before. Our children, 2 of our 3 children have come to the Lord, and our daughter, who's 18 now, told my wife, when she was talking about how she came to the Lord, she said, you know, I was reading my Bible, and I saw this, and I'd never heard this before in some aspect of the gospel. And my wife said to her, I have told you that 100 times. Yes, but she was dead. So we tell them, we point them to Christ. But when Christ opens the eyes, it's totally different. When Christ creates in them a heart that yearns for what's holy, when Christ frees their will, they believe, they desire, and they choose Him. That's a very active response. We're going to talk about that tomorrow. But it's God. And particularly, the Bible says, it's the Spirit of God that does this. Let me read you a couple passages. Ezekiel 36:25. In the Old Testament, he talks about what he would do in the New Covenant. He says, I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them. Jeremiah 31:33, a similar statement. But this is the covenant that I will make with this house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. Do you see the difference? Do you know the difference? Experientially, do you know the difference between having a religion that is a straitjacket that controls your behavior and having a religion where there's no straitjacket, but the rules are written on the heart? And while you still at times sin, you love obedience and you grieve over sin. Samuel Rutherford, the Scottish minister in the 1600s who was in prison for preaching, wrote in one of his letters home to his parishioners, that was it's one of the best books we have by Rutherford. It's not the theological books he wrote, but the letters he wrote when he was in prison. And he said to them, you may put a distance between, or you may distinguish between yourself and a hypocrite, a true Christian and a false professing person. You may distinguish between the true and the false Christian in this way. Are your sins your darlings, or are they your greatest grief? You say, I'm saved by grace. So is your pet sin your darling that you protect against Christ? Or is the fact that you're still capable of sinning a great grief to you? When the preacher says to you, Christians aren't perfect, they're just forgiven, does that thrill you, the idea that you can still sin? Or do you say to the Lord, oh God, for the day that even that is removed? Regeneration. The law is written on the inside. It flows from love. God uses the gospel. James says, of his own will, he begot us. He decided to make us alive and brought us forth by the word of truth. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth. I'm thinking of another translation. And 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 15, Paul writes, for though you might have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet you do not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus, I have begotten you through the gospel. So it's the gospel. We don't want a hyper-Calvinism that says evangelism isn't important if God's just going to save people. That's so unbiblical. So these metaphors, are they overstatements or understatements? When you talk to people and you're sharing the gospel with them, are you aware of how desperately needy they are, not just for the truth of the gospel that you're sharing, but for God himself to speak to the situation? One way you can test your true view of regeneration and the depth of man's sin and the need for God to intervene is to ask yourself, in evangelism, all right, whether you're very evangelistic or not very evangelistic, in the work of witnessing or evangelizing, do you talk to men more or to God more? Because when we realize how impossible it is for us to cleverly state the gospel in a way that will hook them and change them, when we realize that we cannot do that and God is the only one who can make alive, then when we're done talking to them, before we talk to them, after we talk to them, we talk to God. Now, not everyone has agreed that regeneration is so drastic. Throughout history, there have been five major approaches to the doctrine of, or to the act of regeneration. The first is, let me give you these, baptismal. So what denomination or denominations would say that what we're talking about right now actually occurs in a baptistry? Okay, Church of Christ, Roman Catholic, some Anglicans. So there's the baptismal. Now, that's really not your problem, is it? You're not going to your pastor and saying, you got to sprinkle my grandkids so they'll go to heaven. There are other views, though. There's the reformational view. That is, especially within homeschooling families, we find this, all right? And I'm a homeschooler, so I'm not throwing rocks at anybody else, all right? I'm throwing boomerangs. In homeschooling, you can believe the subtle lie that if you raise your children in a healthy environment, then as they're growing up, maybe we should call this really fits more with educational. As they're growing up and you're teaching them Bible things, they don't really need the new birth. They just kind of slowly materialize into good Christians. And they never need to go from death to life because they never were really bad people. They're kind of always Christians. That could be described as an educational regeneration. Reformational really applies more to, imagine a woman who brings her husband to church, maybe they're newly married and he's promised to behave himself and go to church with her. And he looks around and he sees that nobody else is dressed the way he is. Nobody else talks the way he does. Nobody's drinking what he's, you know, the empty cans in his car and the empty cans in Joe's car over here that goes to church. Those, they're two different type of cans. And so he decides he's going to go ahead and make a go of it. He's going to be a good guy, and he cleans up the exterior. And people in the church, maybe not being very careful, look at him and say, "Oh, wonderful, your husband's become a Christian." But has he? Or has he just merely reformed the outside? Reformational. Now, the one that we live with mostly is decisional. If a person makes a decision at the end of a sermon, if a person nods in agreement to the facts that the preacher asks him, if a person repeats the words the preacher gives him to pray, then he is born again through that. And that, of course, is the one that we all have pretty much grown up with, and it has produced decades of results that are disheartening. I want to talk about that again in a minute, so let me go on. Then there is what we could call spiritual regeneration. That is, that the Holy Spirit himself wakes us up, makes us alive, raises us from the dead, opens our eyes, softens the heart. And everything that comes from that, real faith and repentance, real sanctification, perseverance, all the way to the end, flows out of that great event. Now, let's ask ourselves, based on what we talked about in the first half and then just now, I think there are some practical applications. I want us to think about these together, all right? What are some practical applications of the doctrine of regeneration to our day? Number one, if you don't understand regeneration, you can waste a lot of time trying to revive people who have never been made alive. Or you could say, you could waste a lot of time trying to disciple people who have never been made alive. The Puritan writers had this quote. They said, "You can polish a lump of lead all your life, but it will never turn into a lump of gold." Many people who plant churches will contact me and say, "You planted a church years ago. What did you do?" And what they want to talk about always is this. "What about discipleship? That's important, isn't it?" And discipleship is important. And they say, "Discipleship's the missing key, isn't it? Discipleship's everything." And I say to them, "No, I don't agree with that." Because what they mean is this. If only we did better discipleship, we'd have churches full of wonderful followers of Jesus Christ. Well, that would be true if you had churches full of baby Christians, but we've got churches full of dead people. And you can talk to them about how to walk with the Lord all you want, but you cannot disciple a dead person. So they learn how to do their daily Bible readings. They learn how to pray, you know, the acronym ACTS, Adoration, Confession, Thanksgiving, Supplication. But somehow they don't become prayers. And somehow the Bible never really changes them. And somehow, even if you send them off to do ministry, which has happened so very many times, they themselves remain strangers to God. You cannot disciple dead people. You cannot revive dead people. We waste a lot of time writing church programs to disciple the people in churches who have never been made alive because we don't understand the doctrine of regeneration. You have a printout in your packet. The title of it is Revival and the Unregenerate Church Member. Jim Eliff wrote that, right? By Jim Eliff. Anthony got that offline, so it would be a nice readable printout. The one I had for you was pretty wonky. So we're not going to look at that right now, but tonight, before tomorrow, you could read over that and see what he says. There's a lot of really helpful things there. So that's the first application. Let me give you a second application. You will waste a lot of time with an inadequate approach to evangelism if you don't get the doctrine of regeneration correct. If men and women and children who are nice and kind and sweet and churchy, if they're not so bad deep down, if it's not that bad, then maybe we ought to focus on clever techniques for how to help children to understand the gospel, how to help senior citizens understand the value of the gospel, how to help blue-collar workers understand, how to help intellectuals understand. And so, of course, that is what we're doing. We're focusing on methodology. And I'm not saying that there's no value to being careful in our methods and thinking. We don't want to be sloppy. But our overemphasis on methodology is rooted in the fundamental belief that things aren't that bad with the people that sit in front of me. And I just need to know how to say it. When I was in seminary, I took a class called Church Evangelism. It was a first-year class. You know, you have like year one, two, and three in seminary, like in college. And so you're supposed to take it your first year. I took it the last semester. It probably was the last hour of the last day of the last semester because I knew I was not going to be in agreement with this class. And one time the professor was out, so we had to watch a video. And the video was by men who were pastors of really big, successful churches. But now this was 20 years ago, and the video was 20 years old when I watched it. So I knew the names still, and they were still alive, but they were old at that time and retired. But they would hear, the whole video was this, it was 45 minutes explaining this, how to move from the sermon, where at the end of the sermon, you come to an emotional crescendo, you've got the people with you, and you come to the conclusion, and you move right from the conclusion of the sermon into the altar call with no pauses, nothing that would interrupt the emotional pitch so that people will get saved. Because if you're kind of clumsy at the end, then their concentration is broken, the emotions drop, and they won't get saved. And so it was all on how to signal to the pianist how she'll know you're about done with the sermon, and she begins to play quietly. This drives me nuts, people. When I'm in a church and I'm just sitting there listening and the preacher's preaching and I'm listening and the woman starts playing, if you do that, I'm sorry, I don't mean to be personal, but I hate it. I think, don't shut up. I'm it's not over, you know, I'm still listening. And well, on comes the soft music. It gets louder and louder and soon he quits and there's no break. It's wonderful. And that's a great thing to do if that's what it would take to save a person, but it doesn't save anybody. How many times did Jesus Christ talk to people who ask him questions about eternal matters, and his answer to them is such that you think he's trying to shake them off? We waste so much time being clever in our techniques when what we really need is God to take what we're saying and make it effective. Third, all right, put your thinking caps on. Third, nominalism. That's what I'm calling it. I hope that's the right title for it. That is, having a right name or a right label for something, but not having the thing itself in religion. So, nominalism. Still keeping the right words, like, you must be born again. But not really having the substance. People aren't really being born again that we're calling born again. Nominalism, in my opinion, is the most popular abuse of the doctrine of regeneration in our land, in our day. Ministers, parents, well-meaning teachers and friends are calling people born again. You are born again. You are alive from the dead. You are a new creation. You are washed. And they're saying it to people that God doesn't say it to, and deceiving those people. In the 18th century, when George Whitefield said, you must be born again, the Church of England, his church, said, you've gone too far. Those metaphors are merely metaphors. They're meant to kind of give you a general impression, but you're taking them literally. You think these people are spiritually dead and need to be made spiritually alive. And that's not the case. And they said this. You can read their books if you don't believe me. These are good English people. Now, if you go to America and you preach to the Indians, to the savages, or if you go to Africa and you preach to the Africans, Well, they need that, but not us. We're a Christian nation. Listen, that sounds so silly to us, but that's exactly what we're doing that every day. It's hard to find a church that isn't presently doing that. Joey says to Grandma, "Grandma, I don't want to go to hell." So I ask Jesus in my heart, "Are you going to be the evil grandmother that says, 'Joey, I want to talk with you about that?'" And I hope that God really has begun to work. But these are the things that will change in your life as you walk with the Lord. But if you don't have that, I mean, everybody has a couple grandmas. You're going to be the one that is not the favorite grandma. If you say to your children, "I'm not so sure that my grandchild is what you think he is." I mean, it's a common problem that people come, I'm a pastor, so people come up to me all the time and say from my town, "Oh, my kid got saved." And I say, "Really? Tell me about it." "Well, they're kind of young, they're 3, but they got saved this week and we baptized them." And God can work in a child, but I don't know what to say. What I want to say is, come back in a few years when there's fruit, and I will be so happy. At age 9, I went to a revival meeting. My parents made me go to every meeting. I went to a revival meeting, and the preacher said, "Do you want to be on God's team?" And I did not want to be on the devil's team. Who would? So I went forward, and he prayed me through a sinner's prayer, and I meant it. But from age 9 to age 20, I lived an uninterrupted streak of John-centeredness with moments of religion. Now, when at age 20, I saw my heart and was really saved, I wish that people when I was 9 would have said to me, "John, I'm glad you want to be on God's team, but let's talk about who this God is and what is the gospel." 9 is when we put the wrong label on someone. Now, I think that one of the great consequences of that is this: not just that you're deceiving the person that you're talking to and you're saying, "Well, you're a Christian, you're born again." But the next generation, that person grows up. Let's say Joey is 7 years old and you told him he's a Christian. He grows up, he never shows any real interest in Jesus Christ. He grows up, he gets married. His wife is the same kind of a person who's professed Christ but never shown any real interest in Christ. They have a child. Listen, how many generations do you do that before one of the generations grows up and says to Grandma and Grandpa, "I'm not showing up at church this Easter. It's a joke. It's not real. Mom and Dad call themselves Christians. You call yourselves Christians. I don't see the difference." We go, the pattern is this: a people have the substance and the words right. But if we're not careful, the next generation just has the words right. And they don't know that they got to have the substance too. Then the next generation says, "Those words, they're ridiculous. Born again, created anew, alive from the dead. We don't use those words anymore." I mean, look at the trend of liberalism in churches. But it starts with well-meaning people who use the right word for the wrong thing. You could ask yourself this: do you live in a kingdom of words or a kingdom of power? Now, one of the problems is this: it's very costly to rethink these things, because you immediately look at yourself, but then you look at people you love and you say, if these metaphors in the Bible that describe regeneration, if I need to look for some evidence of those metaphors in my loved ones who claim to be Christians, what does that mean? I mean, what if nobody in your family shows any of that? What if those 12 marks of death characterize all your family and you're in church? Most people come up to the edge of that cost and turn back. I mean, you don't lose your salvation. You just stop moving forward there because you say to God, "I'm not willing to face the next step. I'm not willing to think that maybe my wife, my children, maybe I have never known you." So it's costly, but we do well to close with this thought: it is much more costly not to. When I got back from Great Britain. There was a man that was a very godly man and a group of hungry people. Most of them were lost, but they were hungry. And we planted a church in North Mississippi where there are already too many churches, all right? And about a year and a half into the church, I'm a pastor and he's the co-pastor. His wife, he shows up at church, he's just ashen-faced. He's about 62 years old, and he's just a great guy. He recently passed away. Great guy, and he never got down. But he came to church, and I am the most unobservant pastor. So you have to be crying right in front of me for me to say, something wrong with you? So he comes in, and he looks so gutted. And I said to him, is something wrong with you? We need to talk. All right, so we go into this little room. There's only 25 people in the entire church. And he says to me, I've been married to my wife for this many years. She's such a wonderful woman. But she told me this morning, this church is not God's idea. It's Satan's idea. Satan planted this church, and you have ruined my life. You and John Snyder have ruined my life. Because in a small town, when you leave the big church, it causes a stink. So he was blindsided. So he came and told me that. I said to him, I've been praying for her conversion for a while. She is so sweet. You can meet her today. She is so kind. But in one of the conversations with a group of Christian ladies, she said something along these lines. I kind of wish that I had been a bad girl growing up so that I would have felt like I've had to be forgiven of a lot, but I've never had to be forgiven of much. And my wife said to me, did you hear that? And I said, yes. And she outwardly hadn't had to be forgiven of much, but I said, here's a woman that never saw her heart. She's lost. The co-pastor's wife is lost. We're doomed, you know. And so we start praying. 9 months after she says to her husband, this is Satan's idea, not God's. I sit down and talk with her immediately and then keep talking with her about the gospel. She realizes she's lost. 9 months, she's under conviction. I don't know what to say. I've said everything I know to say different ways. I've given her so many books. She spent one day in an 8-hour time alone, praying in a room, reading a book called The Anxious Inquirer, which is a great book, crying out to God to save her. I called her the next day and I said to her, how are you? She said, he won't save me. I'm just not one of the elect. And she was just so bitter. 9 months. I despaired. But her husband did not. He counted the cost of saying to her, I don't know that you really know the Lord. I'm concerned. And he stuck with her through 9 months of really miserable times. And she came to the Lord. She called me and said, he's heard my prayer. The next Sunday we got together, I preached. She used to hide behind people while I was preaching. She's there. I could see her this time. She starts crying through the last hymn. I think, oh, great. I thought she'd come to peace. You know, I think it's going to be one of those, maybe I am, maybe I'm not. So I pulled her aside quickly. I said, I thought you had found peace with God. She said, I have this hymn. And she read the hymn. She said, this is me. He's rescued me. Her husband died a year ago, and she's still such a wonderful servant of the Lord and an encouragement. It cost a lot to rethink regeneration in a day that hasn't rethought regeneration biblically in a long time, but it costs more not to. So, let's ask the Lord for courage. Father, we pray that you would help us to be careful with the truths that you care about. And we ask it in Christ's name and for his name, as well as for our souls and those around us. Amen.